Hello, Australia. Welcome to episode 694 of The Couch. We have got a big show today. Alexander Sacosta is coming in to talk about entertainment and all the gossip around entertainment. Jake Dennis performs for us live on the show. Later on, we'll be talking health, exercise, why it's so important. Dr. Costridge will be in with that one. Talking travel with Steve Collins takes us to New Zealand. What's on Perth with Daniele and Belinda. And later on, we'll talk to the star of the Young Doctors TV show. They're releasing the DVD collection. We'll talk to a guy called Chris King. We all know him as Dennis, the orderly on the Young Doctors. Stay tuned. Big Couch, Big Show, 694. Starts now.
It's showtime on the couch. Hey, it's showtime on the couch. You can see it from your house. You can see it from your house. It's showtime on the couch with Fred.
Hello, Australia. Welcome to another episode of The Couch. Big show coming your way today. Let's get straight into it because it's a big one. Alexander Sacosta, welcome back to The Couch.
Thank you very much, Fred. Happy to be here.
Nice to have you here. Now, you've got lots of stories. You're going to talk about Dancing with the Stars.
With the Stars, yes. Well, have you been watching it?
Look, I must admit I was forced to watch it for two or three nights of the episode. I don't like it because it's pre-recorded. Mm. I don't like it because Daryl looks like he's just about to fall over. I don't like it because Sonia Kruger looks like she has fallen over. And can I say, you got to give credit that Seven are doing local production, but they're also, it's really cheap and tacky and it's not as good as the Channel 10 version. I don't have any fans at 10, right. But I think 10 did it better.
Yeah,
it was more entertaining. It was more fun. And the judges, they're retired for a reason.
Oh, brutal.
What do you think?
Well, actually, I specifically want to talk about Chappelle Corby's appearance on there because that was kind of the most touted.
She did really well.
I think so as well. I think she actually presented quite beautifully. And even when she danced, actually quite good. Yeah, she threw herself into it.
She looked like a different person.
Yeah.
And sounded beautiful the way she spoke.
Well, it was nice to see her kind of have control of her own narrative in the media because she's someone who was very much maligned by a lot of people. And it's nice to have her actually have her voice. And so she should use some of the media attention that she's had for so long to actually
people are so critical. They treat her like a prisoner, even though she did her time. Yeah. She's out of jail. Yep, forget that. She's a guest on that show. People then criticised her for being overweight.
It's horrible.
Hey, what have you learnt about equal opportunity and all the, discrimination stuff?
Yeah.
She did a great job. She was a great dancer.
Yeah, she actually really did very well and, good for her, I think. Yeah, fantastic that she was given that platform.
They recorded the show. Seven recorded all these episodes.
Yes.
There's only 2 weeks of it. I think
It starts again across and then on Sunday nights, yeah.
Correct. So anything else you got to add to that?
Well, I enjoyed that first episode. I didn't watch the second one and,
Well, the ratings started at 750,000, went down to about 5, and now they've gone down to about 3. So there's something wrong with Channel 7 and the show.
Mm.
But good luck to them for the rest of the series. And Big Brother's done as well, and that's all pre-recorded as well.
Maybe they should do a spin-off called Dancing with the Cars, and it's just like celebrities trying to cross roads.
I think so, but you know what? Khloe Kardashian might want to be in that too.
Yes, she would, I'm sure. The Kardashians touch everything and turn it to gold. So in her case, there was a photo that was released of her, which was, now the Kardashians are known for having a very curated image online, as you can see with some of the photos here.
Yep.
And this photo was unedited, it was raw, it was real.
Mm.
And obviously there's something called the Barbra Streisand effect that when you release something and you try to take it back off the internet, it draws more attention to it. So it did in this case, and everyone was sharing this photo around, and she was saying about how it's so unfortunate that there's such a high beauty standard placed upon people, which is kind of incongruent with the fact that they very much perpetuate that as well. So you're kind of like, oh, she's right. There is a high standard put on women and she shouldn't feel that way. But then you're like, but you're also part of it. So very interesting dynamic to see that happen. And then some people say, well, this was all just another calculated thing for them to get more attention. And it worked because we're talking about them right now.
We sure are. Well, we're talking about Neighbours as well. A couple of the cast members, Indigenous cast members
have discussed.
They're saying there's some racial things on set.
And this is interesting, and I'm so glad that these things are coming to the forefront now because I'm sure a lot of these shows, which have been going for a long period of time, develop a kind of workplace culture which isn't kind of as representative of current Australia. And it's good that these are coming to the front now.
But see, Neighbours, I have to say, I don't know where they're getting the information from. Neighbours has got an Indian family.
Yes.
It's got a, they're very multicultural.
Yes.
So I think they've got a guy with a cochlear ear implant. Mm. They've got gay people on there or portrayed on there.
Yeah.
I think they're probably the most diverse and multicultural program on Australian TV.
Well, I guess that's the question then of how things are perceived versus how they are. Mm. So very much you can present yourself in the very progressive way, but then what's behind that, the structures that have existed there, is it still a place where people feel very uncomfortable to speak up? They're worried they'll lose their jobs and things like that. And in an industry where you're so reliant on this kind of work, maybe people don't really feel comfortable to speak up. So it's good to see some people.
So what's been happening? Some of the characters that have been
on the
show.
Some of the former cast members, Sharon Johal, who left the soap last month, said she endured a painful 4 years.
Isn't it amazing that they whinge after they leave the show? After they're written out. I wonder if there's any motive in all that. But fair enough. Taylor Swift,
in the news. Re-released. So this, we've spoken about this before and how she was re-recording. So now she's actually re-released her second album, I believe it is, Fearless. And this is now all her re-recording. So she essentially re-recorded all the songs and released some ones she hadn't actually released before.
Is this because of the copyright issues and now she owns the whole song?
So now if people listen to these ones, a lot of that money goes directly back into her and her business, whereas before it was Scooter Braun who then sold it on to Big Machine Records.
She's a very popular young lady, isn't she?
Good for her. Once again, taking control. She writes her own songs and she sings her own songs, so why should she not profit from that?
And
it's
why
her
should
art.
She own her own songs?
Amen.
I agree with you. Yes. And what's happening with the Yellow Wiggle?
Yellow Wiggle. Emma. She's getting married again. They believe. She was originally married to Lockie, who's the purple wiggle.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
so she's staying. No, I didn't, because I don't follow people.
You don't follow the Wiggles?
Life.
Fred. Please.
No.
Get up on that. So they were married and they got divorced. I'm not sure who got the big red car.
So she's still marrying. Is she going out with somebody else from the Wiggles?
No. She's making her way around. No, she's someone else. What's his name? Oliver Bryan, a bandmate who played the banjo on the show. So, she's potentially getting married
to him. Congratulations to her.
I think good for her.
And I think that's wonderful.
Yeah.
Anything else that's taking your fancy in the way of television
entertainment?
Anything else?
I started watching Them on Amazon Prime.
Is that
really
good?
Quite interesting.
Interesting.
It's dealing with race relations within America, and it's kind of got this horror element to it.
Well, I'll tell you what, for your next in 2 weeks' time, can you find out a little bit about the Logies?
Oh, yeah.
Is that coming? Apparently, it's going to be happening this year very soon. I'd love to know what we're going to be voting for, what we're going to see, and when is it going to be?
Can do, friends.
Sounds good. Now, if people want more information about you, because you're an actor, you're a presenter on Home in WA,
I'll dance on the street for money. I'll do whatever.
Where do they go?
www.alexandersacosta.com.
You heard it from him. Thank you, Alexander. We'll see you in a couple of weeks.
Thank you, Fred. Always a pleasure.
That is it. We're going to go to a music act now because he's ready centre stage, actually. Jake Dennis is right here today. He's got a beautiful song by Gladys Knight. Here he is performing a beautiful song. Like I said, it's called Neither One of Us. Here's Jake.
It's sad to think we're not gonna make it. And it's gotten to the point where we just can't fake it. For some ungodly reason, we just won't let it die. Ooh, I guess neither one of us wants to be the first to say goodbye. I keep wondering what I'm gonna do without you, and I guess you must be wondering that same thing too. So we go on together, living a life. Wants to be the first to say goodbye. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Every time I find the nerve, every time I find the nerve to say I'm leaving. Oh, oh, memories, those old memories get in my way. Whoa, oh, oh, Lord knows it's only me. Oh, he knows it's only me that I'm deceiving. Ooh, when it comes to saying goodbye, that's a simple word that I just cannot say. There can be no way, there can be no way this can have a happy ending. No, no. So we just go on hurting and pretending. And convincing ourselves to give it just one more try. I guess neither one of us wants to be the first to say it, Lord have mercy. Neither one of us wants to be the first to say it. Oh, neither one of us wants to be the first to say farewell, my love, goodbye.
Thank you very much to Jake Dennis, always a wonderful performer. He's been with us since the age of 15. I think he's now 32, I believe. So well done. Thank you very much. We'll catch up with you another time. Neisha Seth is on set again with our good friend Dr. Joe. Over to you.
Wonderful. Thank you, Fred. And welcome back to the couch, Dr. Joe.
Good to be with you, Neisha. Nice to see you, Fred.
Thank you, Joe.
It's always lovely to have a medical professional coming on board with such a great character, but also a passion for sharing his knowledge with us. What are we talking about today?
Look, the importance of exercise. It's an oldie, but goodie. And you know, we're coming out of summer. People start to sort of think about hibernation, but you know, it remains very, very important to be doing some regular exercise. There was some work came out 2 or 3 weeks ago suggesting that lack of physical activity may be a contributor to, not the only factor. I think it's really important when we see these studies that it's not the only factor, but a contributor to as many as 1 in 8 deaths from sort of conditions worldwide. So we're talking about sort of heart disease, diabetes, high blood pressure. Now the list goes on where exercise can be a useful factor. Not saying that if you exercise you can't drop dead of a heart attack. Yeah, just want to be very clear on that. But it's something that does help.
Wonderful. And we know that exercise is helpful not just physically but also psychologically. And why is that important at the moment with, I guess, you know, being different stages of being sedentary at home and being back in the workplace?
Look, I mean, obviously it's been a very stressful 12 months, and one of the biggest stresses for people is not quite knowing what's going to happen next. That, you know, if somebody sneezes twice and they can lock the borders again, you're going to go and visit your elderly relatives and all of a sudden you can't. You're going to go and, you know, visit your grandchildren and all of a sudden you can't. If you know that you can't go, you're not going to like it, but you can sort of get adjusted to that when you don't know what they're going to do next. Very, very stressful for people. I think one of the real unrecognised factors of these sort of policy changes. But we know that exercise is very, very good for people's mental health. We know that people who do regular exercise are up to 30 to 40% less likely to suffer from depression and anxiety. We also know that if people do have mental health problems, that some regular exercise is very good, and also for stress management as well.
And we know that we're all on a different continuum for everything. So if our audience is sitting out there thinking, oh, I go for a walk once a week, you know, what would you say? How do you assess and get started? How do you get motivated?
Going for a walk once a week is a very, very good start.
Yep.
Walking is an underrated form of exercise. Mm. Costs next to nothing. Mm-hmm. Look, you can go and buy some fancy walking shoes if you want to, but you don't have to. You need shoes that are comfortable. Yeah. Okay, I wouldn't necessarily suggest going out and walking in high heels. That might not go so well, and maybe not in your office shoes. You
what
could,
if it's just down the road to the local restaurant?
Look, it was down the road to the restaurant, okay. Look, you can start going for a walk, you know, literally if you haven't done much exercise, you can go around the block. And then you can go around the block twice. Then you can try and do a bigger block.
So
and
a graduated increase.
Pace up.
So
the three main forms of exercise are cardiovascular exercise. So that's walking, jogging, running, swimming, bike riding.
Get the heart pumping.
You can do, Zumba classes, those there's a whole host of them. And then there's resistance type exercise, which is using weights. Now it doesn't have to be heavy weights. You don't have to try and become Arnold Schwarzenegger. and you can use your body's own weight, so people can do chin-ups or press-ups. And then there's stretching type exercise.
Okay.
So for example, things like yoga and Pilates. And all three have a role. You never want to go out the first day and try and overdo it. Two reasons for that. One, the obvious, it's probably you're not going to go very well. But if you do end up injuring yourself, then you're going to think, well, I'm not going to do this, and it puts you, as it were, out of the game. So much better to go slowly. If you haven't done much by way of resistance exercise for a while, then go to maybe think about joining a gym if that's where you're inclined, and have a chat with a trainer. Sometimes throwing some money at some personal training sessions is a very, very good thing, because if you get your technique right, then number one, you're going to get more out of your sessions, and number two, you're far, far less likely to to come a cropper.
Beautiful. I've heard psychologically, if you have a trainer, that you're actually committed to the trainer. So sometimes when you're not motivated to actually go to the gym and do the exercise, you don't want the trainer to miss out on that catch up with you. So is having a trainer sometimes a good commitment?
I think so.
Yeah.
And look, got to say, it's not going to be for everybody for a variety of reasons, including economic ones. But it does. You put it in your diary.
Or a buddy. It doesn't have to be a trainer.
Could
it could
be a
just
buddy,
be someone you go
somebody
with.
You meet and train with. But it means you've got a commitment. Rather than, I might just go to the gym, do something else instead. It's, I actually have to be at the gym at whether it's 7 a.m. or 6 p.m., whatever time it might be, that whether it's with a trainer or somebody you're meeting there, you've made a commitment to another person. So there is a degree of, accountability in making some form of commitment to somebody other than yourself. You should be accountable to yourself. Absolutely what we should all be. But being accountable to somebody else puts an external factor in.
Wonderful. And finally, I have to ask you briefly, exercise is a very proactive thing to do, particularly if people are looking to get the vaccine, the COVID vaccine. We want to be as fit and healthy before, perhaps, as well. So
there's a lot you can do to look after your own health, and some latest research shows that regular exercise might be good for dampening down inflammation, and other work has shown it is good for immunity. In terms of the COVID vaccine, to be totally honest, I'm not sure that whether you're regularly exercising or not is going to particularly influence its impact. It'll it'll have a role. And look, despite some of the doom and gloom that you hear, the rollout is actually going quite well in this country. It's a little bit sad that people who perhaps should know better seek to, for whatever reasons, and I'm not privy to those reasons, make out that things aren't going well in this country. Look, we're not as far ahead as the United States or the UK, but we didn't need to be. So we do want to get everybody done, hopefully through the course of 2021. And I suspect that we'll get there at least to 80-90%, and that's absolutely fine.
Great. That's a very positive and realistic approach. Anything else you'd like to share with the audience today?
coming into winter, normal colds and the normal flu hasn't gone away, and flu vac season is also starting, and that is one point I think to make, Nisha, that for anybody who's having a COVID shot or a flu shot, and most the older people over the age of 70 will be getting both, that they need to be 14 days apart. And when you go to your clinic, they'll tell you that, but very, very important. And there's not an urgency. So if people say, "Oh, I've had my COVID shot, will I miss out on the flu shot?" No, you can wait 14 days.
Thank you. That's good reassurance for everyone. We could talk to you all day. Lots of interesting stuff. Where do we go to find out more, though, if people need
contact? Go to the website, drjoetoday.com.
Okay, wonderful. Well, always a pleasure to have you on, and we'll look forward to seeing you very soon.
Lovely, Nisha. Thacks for having me.
Of course, if you missed any of that, thecash.com.au, our Facebook page as well, of course. Back to you, Fred.
Thank you, Nisha. Quick question for Dr. Joe before we go to the break.
Yeah.
Dr. Joe, what do you do for exercise?
I go running a couple of times a week, and I've had a personal trainer. Sing out to Tom Scioia at Plus Fitness in Subi for about the last decade or more. I've been training with Tom. He keeps me in shape.
There you go. He does what he says he does. Thank you very much,
good.
Dr. Joe. Thanks, Nisha. We're going to take a break. Coming up after the break, we're taking you to New Zealand. Well, Steve Collins is in a bubble that's coming up very soon. Join us on the couch after the break. Welcome back to The Couch. Always nice to have him in the studio. Steve Collins, if he's not making us laugh, he's making us want to travel. Today's talking travel. Oh, sometimes you talk property as well.
But today we're talking travel and big news!
What's happening?
Travel bubble with New Zealand.
Pop.
So we can go overseas on a holiday.
Isn't that good? Because a lot of people have been wondering, when can we travel again? That started on the 19th.
Started on the 19th, that's correct.
Good to hear.
Now, they're anticipating that in the beginning, it'll be mainly relatives, visiting relatives and stuff like that. But tourists will get there, and Tourism New Zealand is doing a few promotions as well to get people to go and visit New Zealand because New Zealand is an absolutely fabulous country. It's pretty much like visiting a smaller part of Australia but with much bigger mountains and much greener
scenery.
It is
beautiful.
It is lovely. It's an incredible place. Now, I used to live there. I used to live in Wellington many, many years ago, and Wellington's one of my favourite cities. But we'll start with the North Island because certainly from Perth, that's if you want to fly direct, you fly direct into Auckland. And the North Island is incredible because it's got so much thermal activity. That's where I used to live. That's Wellington, most beautiful city, the most beautiful harbour in Wellington, and it's just fabulous.
Very
pretty. All the houses are wooden houses because it shakes a bit. I went through a couple of earth tremors were there. That's their parliament. They call it the Beehive, and that's, I think, the largest wooden building in the world.
The parliament?
Yeah, that's their parliament. And this is terrific because it's very hilly, and you take this cable car or this tram up the hill and you get the most exquisite views right over Wellington. It's a lovely place. As you can see, it gets a bit of cloud.
Is it cold? Is it a cold place?
Oh, Wellington is. It's the windiest place I've been. Now, this is Rotorua. This is where the North Island is so much different from the South Island because all of this thermal activity that's going on, that's
smelly
a geyser,
stuff, isn't it?
And that comes up and it's predictable, and then you've got the boiling mud and it's incredible.
Have
a smell of sulphur. Yeah. These are all these hot pools there, and you can smell the sulphur and you can see the sulphur in the colours of the water. Mm. But it's just a fantastic experience to go there. It's really unusual because you get there and there's a lot of Maori activity around Rotorua, and there are several Maori villages that you can go and visit there and just get to know their lifestyle. We're still in Rotorua. It's just the most incredible.
Steve, you know,
there's 14 lakes around Rotorua. Wow.
You know how we saw the bubbling water in that?
Yeah.
Can you actually physically go in there? Won't burn
Well, you
us.
Probably could, but you'd boil yourself to death. It's very hot. And this is one of the Maori villages that you can visit. And you go in there and they do a hangi, which is where they cook the food underwater, and then they put on display. Now, this, if you've seen Lord of the Rings and The Hobbit, this is Hobbiton. And this is the most fantastic film set. They were going to demolish it, and then they started filming The Hobbit, so they rebuilt it. And they rebuilt it so that now that it's a permanent structure. But if you've seen any of those films, you walk around Hobbiton, that's the pub, and that is now a real pub, so you can go there and have a meal. We're now in Auckland, which is the biggest city in the South Pacific, and there are a lot of islanders live there, but it's an incredible. There are 7 volcanoes.
Oh, wow.
Just in
Auckland.
In Auckland, although most of them are dormant. I mean, it's pretty good. So that's the North Island, and it really is. It takes you about eight hours to drive from Auckland to Wellington.
Yep.
But there is so much to see. You really need to stop. You really need to about a week to do it.
What would you recommend if I want to go skiing?
Well, you can go to Mount Ruapehu on the North Island, but if you really want to go skiing, then we're going to go to the South Island. And the South Island is where you have the much higher
This
Alps
is Queenstown,
there.
Isn't it?
Well, Queenstown is one of them. There are so many places on the South Island. Because, I mean, look at the mountains. That is like looking at the Himalayas. The highest mountain is Mount Cook, which is in the old languages over 16,000 feet. You have these wonderful, wonderful lakes there as well. the most spectacular scenery. And look at the colour of the lakes. It's just that azure beauty.
We drove, Steve, from Christchurch down with a bus.
Yeah.
And you get the most amazing stops.
Yeah, that is just incredibly beautiful. This is Milford Sound, which is enormous. I mean, that's a full-size cruise ship. And look, it's dwarfed by everything. And you've got these massive waterfalls.
There's an awesome cruise.
There's some great little train trips. And also down there, this is a rainforest, but it's not a tropical rainforest. It's a temperate zone rainforest. Dunedin has the world's steepest street.
Yes, I believe so.
And so there you go. It's just gorgeous. And this is down near Dunedin as well. You can go off now this is surfing at Dunedin. I don't know that I would surf at Dunedin because the water down there is really, really cold.
Oh, right.
But it's fantastic. See, there's the seals. There's the New Zealand fur seals. And look at the mountains in the backdrop. And here you go. That's one of the snow fields. As I say, as you say, Queenstown is a really, really fascinating place. And a lot of Australians go there for skiing. In fact, you can get direct flights to Queenstown from Sydney, Melbourne, I think also Brisbane. So if you wanted to go to Queenstown, you'd go via Melbourne or Sydney.
So we can't fly from Perth because
we can't fly direct to Queenstown.
At the moment either.
At the moment, normally pre-COVID, there were direct flights.
Correct.
From Perth to Auckland, and also during the summer months from Perth to Christchurch. Now, they will come back because there'll be a lot of people that will be wanting to fly to New Zealand. But look, it's wonderful.
It's a great place
to go. It's wonderful
to
know that we can go overseas. And the great thing about New Zealand is the New Zealand dollar is worth a lot less than the Australian dollar, so everything is cheaper over there.
It is, and they've got everything. I tell you what, you'd swear you were in another state of Australia. The people are beautiful.
Apart from the accent, of course.
Yeah, but you know what?
I mean, they don't use vowels in New Zealand. But no, it is some of the most beautiful spots. I mean, I was telling you earlier that we went to a wedding on Waiheke Island, which is in one of Auckland's harbours. Auckland actually has two harbours. It's a very greedy place, a bit like Albany. Yep. Albany's got two harbours as well. We're a 30-minute ferry ride from Auckland, and you would not know you're anywhere near a capital city. There were 14 wineries on Waiheke Island, and we went to a wedding at one of the wineries, most beautiful spot.
Lots to do there, Steve.
Oh, there's so much to do.
Where do we find out more information? Sonia's giving us the wrap-up again.
Well, you can go to tellmewheretogo.com.
Up on screen right now, the website.
Up on the screen right now. And we have a lot of information about New Zealand. Or you can
and daily news as well.
Yes, I do a daily news, and we do talk about New Zealand. We talk about everywhere in the daily news.
Steve Collins, Talking Travel, always heaps to talk about, never enough time. We'll have him back in a couple of weeks' time. I think you're talking property then.
We are. Yep.
We'll talk to Steve Collins. Thank you for coming in.
Thanks very much.
And look forward to going to New Zealand, as do most of Australian people. Well, looking out for a holiday. Look out for it. Go Virgin or Jetstar. They both fly there. We're going to give away some pizza. Thanks to Bites Pizza, Steve wants it as well. They are amazing. Try their slab. They've got so many beautiful pizzas. If you would like to win a $25 voucher, so you can try Bites Pizza in Balcatta, all you have to do is put the code word, which is Bites, B-Y-T-E-S, on an SMS. Send it to 0439 929 929. Put your name and address on it, and we will give one away every week. Now, you need to be north of the river here in Perth, otherwise they won't deliver if you're down in Mandurah. Obviously, the pizza would be hard, cold, and horrible. But it is beautiful pizza, thanks to Bites Pizza. Now, Nisha's back on couch. We've done a swap, and Nisha's talking to our wonderful friend of ours, Suzanne Warner. Over to you, Nisha.
Thank you, Fred. Very excited to have Suzanne Warner, a great friend of the couch, and also talking to us about Revelation Film Festival again this year. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, we're getting excited. We're going to plan it for July. We're going ahead with it. We're going to go in person after last year was such a crazy year, so we're looking forward to it.
And of course, this year it's in person, so we're going to have a little bit more socialisation. Tell us a bit about what to expect.
Well, we're going to run from the 1st to the 11th of July. So we're going to have, once again, we'll have almost, I think, about 200 films, whether they be features or shorts or all various kinds of things. So we're packing in that program as we speak. And then we want to punctuate it with workshops and special events as well.
Oh, that's awesome. So workshops. Tell me about those.
Well, everything from drone photography. We've got a great filmmaker who we'd like to get involved, who's going to teach us all about drone photography. Mm-hmm. We want to talk about distribution of films. If you've made a film, what do you do with it? And just various parts of the industry. We've got women in film and television wanting to talk about our female writers. So we want to discuss these things and what we can do with them.
So really education and awareness as much as entertainment. So you can really, there's something for everyone.
Oh, well, you always say that. Yeah. Absolutely. There's always something for everyone.
And I've been, went in person as well as last year online, and there is always something. There's always something you least expect that you sign up to.
That's the good thing about Rev is you think you know everything, and then you watch another film about something and you go, oh my gosh, I did not know that. How did I not know that?
So tell me about Blind Date.
So Blind Date is a special thing. We brought it back. We did this a few years ago. We brought it back for this year where we are teaming a musician or a bunch of musicians with filmmakers. So at the moment we've got over 70 songs that have been submitted. Mm-hmm. And what we then do is get filmmakers who put their hand up and they pick a song and then they create a music video for that.
Sure.
So we call it Blind Date because they don't necessarily have to meet.
Mm.
They can if that's what they want to do. But so they maybe might not come together until the very end where we screen it at Rev. We have a special showcase of theirs.
And how did this idea come up? Because it's new, right?
Yeah. We sort of, just chatting. I love music videos. I grew up wanting to make music videos. So I've been pushing Jen Jamison, who's been working with us. She's been pushing it. So we've just finally said, okay, yeah, let's do this.
That's so exciting. And tell me more about what else is in the festival, because I know there's City of Vincent films, so there's specific films that are being featured as well.
So what we do every year is we commission three films with the help of the City of Vincent. They fund these films. Mm. And they're films about something to do with the City of Vincent. Mm-hmm. And one we've got happening this year is about the letterboxes of City of Vincent. And then we've got one which is about a guy called Richard Pace who is at the Beattie Park swimming pool every morning and has this whole community there. So they really vary. We're also doing one about RTR, the radio station.
Okay. So it's honouring legacy in a sense as well.
Yeah. Yes.
Beautiful. So tell me about, you come to a show. What's unique about Revelations for those out there that have never been to the festival?
What you're getting there is you're getting such a variety of stuff. You know, when we say there's something for everyone, there truly, truly is. You've got kids' stuff, you've got quite obscure stuff as well. We have an experimental session, we have animation, we've got everything. So when you come along, you can see whatever you want to see. But then you can come and talk to the people about it. Come and argue with Jack and Richard, who's our festival director and our program director.
So they're available.
They're come and argue with them and say, I hated that film. Why on earth did you program that?
Yeah.
And they love nothing more than an argument about that sort of stuff.
Oh, that's so beautiful, Suzanne, because we only grow through actually being able to be open and have those conversations, right?
Absolutely.
The art of storytelling at its best.
And that's the that's the thing. We want to get these stories out, and we have a lot of filmmakers who we involve, and so it might not just be Jack and Richard you can talk to, it might be the filmmaker themselves, so who knows.
Okay, and now the program, I know it's not completely printed yet, but is there anything that you can sort of give us some excitement about, any particular shows that are, films
I've
that are coming out?
I've seen a couple of the documentaries, and I got to say, I love these.
Okay, don't worry.
They're my absolute favourite, the docos, so there's some really interesting ones about... They don't sound so interesting when you say them, but when you see the trailers, you're like, oh my gosh, how do people live like that? So we've got lots of docos about how different people live in different ways.
And international, right? So we've got films from different countries.
Absolutely. Yeah. We usually have about 30 countries represented.
Well, great to increase the cultural understanding at the moment since we can't travel. Or to New Zealand, as Steve mentioned earlier, which is really exciting.
Fabulous. Yeah.
Now, what are the dates? Because I know it's July, but when
1 to 11 of July, we will be happening. Yeah. We'll be on, so we're looking forward to that.
Beautiful. When do tickets go on sale?
So they'll go on sale at the end of May. Mm-hmm. So we'll spend the next few weeks pulling our hair out and putting together the last bits of this program, and then end of May we'll launch it and tickets will be on sale.
Wonderful. And where do people go to get the tickets?
Probably the best place to go is to either the Lunar Palace website or to our own website.
Wonderful. Suzanne, so excited. Another year of Revelation. Great to have you on the show again, and I'm sure we'll have you on very soon.
Hope so.
Okay, and if you've missed any of that, of course, you can go to thecouch.com.au, our Facebook page. But for now, it's back to you, Fred.
Thank you, Nisha. Well done. And can I ask Susie a question for you? Young filmmakers, can they start sending through stuff for next year or for this year?
We've closed the submissions for now, but we will open them again come September.
Yep.
But certainly the blind date competition is something they could really do now. That's a really great way to cut your teeth on the industry.
So check out your website for details.
Yeah, absolutely.
Fantastic. Revelation Film Festival. Susie is the communication manager. She's the boss as well. She does everything. Makes you the coffee as well, I think. Wonderful organisation. Please support them. They're coming back with COVID, of course, being behind us. We hope we have a great season in July and on from there. Thank you, Denisha. We'll take a quick break. Coming up after the break, we're actually going to be talking to Belinda and Daniele about some events that are coming up around Perth on What's on Perth. We'll talk next. Welcome back to The Couch. Time to talk about what's on in Perth. You've got two people. Very special event today. We've got Belinda, of course, Cipriano, as always, with What's on Perth. And we've got an addition, our usual cook and theatre guy. And you're joining us as well, Danielle. Yeah,
double doing trouble today.
Yeah. I think I don't know which one is the trouble, buddy. But thank you for coming in. Thanks to both of you. Now, today we've got a few events to go through. So let's get straight into it. Danielle, you've got three events we're going to talk about today. Let's go to your first one, the Chicken and Beer Festival coming up soon.
Yeah, so we've got Chicken and Beer Festival. So if you love chicken, it's happening in Market Square in Subiaco, 23rd, 24th and 25th of April. There's all different types of chicken dishes. So you've got Jamaican style chicken, Japanese chicken, southern fried chicken. The people from Satchmo. Yeah. People from Satchmo.
Portuguese chicken.
Oh, no, because they're not fried.
Yeah. Oh, okay, sorry. So this is all fried stuff, is it?
Oh, there's different variations as well. Yep. One exciting vendor that's coming is Satchmo, who based in North Perth, and they don't normally do food events, so they're bringing their food truck there.
So is this the first one we've ever had?
This is the first chicken and beer. Inaugural. So there's lots of different kinds of food and alcohol pairings, but this is chicken and beer.
Sounds good.
Yeah, and so there's lots of different types of beers as well. Some brand new Fat Bull are launching a brand new beer there as well. And it's also for the family event as well. So there's kids rides, silent disco. Different sessions.
Lots of stuff happening. The information screen is on screen right now. 23rd to 25th, it's at Market Square in Subiaco. Check out that website we've got on screen at the moment. You can buy your tickets. Please do so, because you've only got another week or so to get those tickets. Sounds fantastic. What about Nightingale? What's that all about?
Yeah, so Nightingale, it was a brand new production that West Australian Opera did last year. And what's really exciting about this opera is it's an opera by children, by young artists, for young artists. So it's a retelling of the Hans Christian Andersen fairy tale about the emperor and the nightingale, but it's done with instead of the traditional Chinese setting, it's set in a circus. So it's a different retelling. Yeah, so it's interesting, it's different. It was really well received last year, and so we're bringing it into the regions with our first stop in Mandurah at Mandurah Performing Arts Centre, and there's going to be two performances, a traditional setting, and there's also a relaxed performance. So if there's younger children or people with special needs that want to ask some questions throughout the performance, they're more than welcome.
And the details are on screen right now. If people want to buy tickets for that one, and that's going to be in Mandurah to start with. Brookfield's Perfect Pairing Dinner.
Yeah, so also theme with opera, Perfect Pairing. So part of Wayo's The Barbarous Fool, which is an opera that's kind of about mistaken identity and mismatched pairings and a bit of matchmaking. So West Australian Opera have teamed up with Brookfield Place and some of the venues there, Heritage Wine Bar, Bar Lafayette, W. Churchill, and they're kind of creating these different pairings of dishes that have like a little bit of a twist and a bit of mystery to them with drinks, and it's a progressive dinner. So there'll be some opera performances.
Sounds great. Great combination.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Belinda and I would like to come, so if you can all buy some beautiful tickets for us.
More the merrier.
Is there a lot happening in Perth? I know, Belinda, with yours, there's a lot. There's been events coming up all the time.
Oh, yeah.
I know you do a lot of theatre stuff, Danielle, as well, and cooking demonstrations, etc. Is there a lot happening in your field of work as well with the PR stuff?
Yeah, it's been very busy. And, you know, we're so lucky to be able to perform, especially with people in the industry, our peers around the world that aren't able to. So. Yeah, it's a fun
time.
When
are you doing more cooking? Because people love your cooking.
Yeah, well, I recently did cooking with opera with the city of Subiaco. So that was lots of cooking and videos. And we did demonstration and a cooking workshop with Multicultural Language Centre. So when time permits, because lots of other events happening. Very busy. We can, we will.
Well, thank you very much, Danielle, for spending the time with us today.
No, thank you for having me.
And coming to those events, which are wonderful. Belinda, over
to
you.
Hello, Fred.
This is like part B.
I know.
Sunday singles at the Comedy Lounge. What's
How
that all
fun
about?
Does this sound? Sunday singles at the Comedy Lounge. One of my girlfriends went to this a couple of weeks ago and I saw it on her socials and she raved about it. Yep. She said it was the best singles event happening in Perth. So it's held at the Comedy Lounge. Mm-hmm. Tickets are $37.50. You go along, they do games like Perfect Match and Freak in the Sheets. I think it's called Blind Date.
Yes, I remember Blind Date. Do you remember Blind Date?
Yeah, yeah.
Your compatibility is gone.
That was Perfect Match with Dexter.
Well, with Blind Date, wasn't that the same
Blind
show,
Date
just a different name?
When they went out for dinner in Sydney.
Channel 7 thing, so I don't watch Channel 7 ever. So that's, I understand which one you mean.
So, and if you find somebody that you know, tickles your fancy, you can head on over to the after party at the Avery, which is also fun, I hear, and they kick on to the, So anyway, so Fred, maybe you and I will go and have a look.
I was going to say, starting to look more like Belinda's social life. Dad, we got your diary instead. Dining in the Dark at the Stables Bar.
This is another one that I heard of from a colleague of mine, and she was telling me about how she was trying different things, and one of the things she was looking at was Dining in the Dark. Now, this is held at the Stables Bar by the team at Fever Up.
Yeah.
Which is interesting. So Stables Bar are holding these events Tuesdays and Wednesday nights up until August 25, I believe.
Yeah.
Tickets are $110 and it's all about using your senses to taste your meals. So it's in the dark, only by candlelight. They blindfold you and you can choose from either a vegan, a seafood,
so you know
or meat
roughly
option.
What you're going to get.
Yeah, and you're always
guaranteed. I've done that in Bali where they used to have a candles restaurant. I'm thinking of the name, but I can't remember now. And it was all dark. And you just used to wait for your food.
Were you blindfolded?
No, but you couldn't see. It was dark. It was like no light whatsoever. So you'd see someone bring the food and you'd be going, I'll eat. Where is it?
What is it? Well, anyway,
Bali, it's a bit worrying.
I'm looking forward to hearing what she has to say, but I'm interested to actually go and try this one out.
Fevereup.com for details.
Yeah, for dining in the dark.
What can we do for Mum on Mother's Day?
There's so much going on for Mother's Day this year. I believe the Ritz are doing something, the Westin is doing something, the Sea Restaurant always does a nice high tea there. Mm-hmm. So take your mum out, but my choice this year, although some mums might think that they're at the zoo every single day of the week, but the Perth Zoo are treating mum to Mother's Day.
Really?
So mums can go in for free. What a treat. Take your mum to the zoo. It's a beautiful time at the zoo, actually. I love it. But because you're not paying to enter, I think you should treat them to an up-close and personal encounter. Now,
with
I don't
a lion.
Know... Yeah, so some people might think this is really weird.
Get your mum ready.
Would your mum be into this?
No. Not the, I think the every day is a close one.
Yeah, I know.
So.
My mum does too. But I've done this. It's been on my bucket list for years. But they do these really up close and personal encounters.
Yeah.
I've got to feed giraffes, which
giraffes
is really beautiful.
Crocodiles.
Elephants, I'm okay. I don't mind.
I tell you what, the lion experience was one of the most amazing experiences I've ever had.
You actually were close to a lion?
Well, you're between a cage. So you're feeding meat between a cage and you feed it through the little holes. But it's just incredible. So something like that, I think it'd be fantastic for a mum.
That's the Perth Zoo.
Yeah.
Fantastic idea for Mother's Day.
Yep.
And the Queens are coming back to Elmer's in the Valley.
Yeah, I like this one. Drag Queen Show at Elmer's in the Valley. You get a two-course meal. Mm-hmm. It's $69. Entertainment. You get to dance with your drag queens. It's so much fun. I think Friday, May 21st from 7
p.m. I don't know if Danielle and I will look good in drag with one with the beard, me with the size. And I can't walk in high heels. I'm sorry. It's a new look.
I think it's so much fun.
It is fun.
It's definitely one that I'm popping on the list as well. So that's always a good night out. I love a good drag show. So pop that one on the
Check
list.
Check that one out. That's Elmer's in the Valley as well. Fantastic.
So
and the last
21.
One is Sip and Socials. What's
yeah,
that
Sip
all about?
And Socials. So I'm heading to this one. So Sip and Socials by Social EM. M. Williams. She's a Perth girl. She is a boss babe. Absolutely incredible woman.
Yep.
Mother, I think, three. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry if I got that wrong. But she's incredible. So she holds these all around the country and she's actually heading to Brisbane and Melbourne for this tour. It's all about women supporting women.
Great idea.
Great idea. The June 1, which is happening in Perth, June 5, she's bringing over Sophie Kasha and Emmylou McCarthy.
Emmylou McCarthy.
Former Perth girl. So she has come from nowhere and she is absolutely killing it in the social media space.
Yep.
She's a powerful, powerful woman. And they're coming over. It's going to be entertainment, food,
grazing
drinks.
Station, entertainment, 1 hour panel session.
Yep.
A heap
with
of networking girls. Opportunity. Epic. Is that goodies bags as well?
A goodie bag.
And tickets
which I believe,
are selling fast.
Yeah, tickets are selling fast, and I believe the goodie bag is worth the ticket itself. So get on out. I know that that is going to sell out. I missed out last year, so I'm definitely looking forward to this one at the Ritz-Carlton.
Well done. Have you guys, do you get to stay at those new hotels?
I have not yet.
No, I haven't stayed at the Ritz. Can I just say the Ritz? If you want to send us there, we've heard you've got beautiful bathtubs and everything.
Yeah.
But we're happy.
Pool.
We're available every night, by the way.
Yeah.
Good on you, Belinda. Good on you to you too, Daniele. Thank you for both coming in.
Thank you.
We'll see you in about a month's time with more events. And Daniele, we'll see you when you've got more events, when you've got about a minute or two.
Yeah, for sure.
Spare.
Always love to come
and don't
here.
Forget, the beard needs to go for the drag show.
Uh-huh.
Please. But then again, it might be someone's fancy.
That's it.
Thank you very much for being on the show today.
Thank
We're going to take a break. We're going to talk to a legend from the Young Doctors TV shows. His name is Chris King. He was Dennis in the Young Doctors. That's next.
Connect with The Couch online through Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube.
Welcome back to The Couch. It gives me great pleasure to go back in time to a TV show that I used to love when I was younger. It was called The Young Doctors on Channel 9 in Australia. And on the phone, or on Zoom, should we say, the modern technology, Zoom is one of the actors, the original actors. His name is Chris King. Chris, welcome to the show. Thanks for being with us today.
Hi, Fred. Thank you, mate. Good to be here.
You're looking good. And can I say, it's nice to have you here bringing back something that I absolutely used to love, and I know other people do too. We're going to talk about The Young Doctors, the DVD collection that's coming out. But for those people who have never watched The Young Doctors, tell us a little bit about it.
Well, I guess the most important thing was it was Reg Grundy's last shot at drama. Reg, of course, being a great game show producer, had a number of shots at drama. The Young Doctors was it, and, you know, if it had not worked, well, we wouldn't have a whole heap of Prisoner, you name it.
Well, you had everything. Reg Grundy was into quiz shows. My favourite show was Prisoner, I had to say. It sort of beat The Young Doctors. But I remember being a kid. I think you used to be on it about, was it 6 o'clock, 6.30 or 5.30?
5.30. Actually, 5.30 to leave into the Nine News.
That's it.
And we were there for nearly 8 years. We were the longest running television show in Australia's history. And that, of course, was overtaken by Home and Away and Neighbours.
Yep.
But, hey, you know, it was back then, it was an amazing era of TV. And, what a show it was.
Yep.
But it had really humble beginnings. It got axed. And then Nine were going to do The Sullivans or Young Doctors.
Mm.
But The Young Doctors proved so popular they had to do both.
You had some amazing actors who were part of the cast with you. You want to go through some of the names for me? I know Karen Tapano, Abigail, Mark Holden, but who else?
Cornelia Francis, Gwen Plum, Michael Beecher, Alfred Sandor. You've mentioned Mark Holden, Johnny Waters, you know, Judy McBurney, Tim Page. It was a really ensemble of amazing people. And, of course, Russell Crowe.
Exactly. That's probably where he got his start in television or movies, I guess, the first acting job.
He was, mate, he was 15, and interestingly enough, I saw him in the canteen and befriended him, showed him around the studio, and interestingly enough, years later, I met up with Russell when I was managing a lady called Tony Pirin, and we had a night out on the town together because he remembered that I'd always been that sort of friendly and shown him around. He was only 15, so it was quite amazing.
You're amazed, amazing. Can I just say, we did an interview with you on Radio 6PR here in Perth. And I had that many people write to me, tell me how wonderful an interview it was and how great.
Oh, thank you.
And people love the fact we're bringing them back to The Young Doctors. And they felt young again, and times were different back then. I mean, if you look back now, what was so different that The Young Doctors got away with back then that you probably couldn't do now?
Well, I guess, Fred, you know, when you think about it, I started in television at TVT6 in Hobart way back when, and Young Doctors was relatively young. There were some great values in the Young Doctors. Reg Grundy was a great producer. Kerry Packer had a personal interest in the show. I don't know, it was just we never tried to be anything more than we were.
There was no political correctness back then, was there? Political correctness was just,
You know what, though? But we didn't, interestingly enough, our producers didn't have a smoke on the show. Really? There was Bunny Place, and of course, Ugly Dave Gray was Bunny. Yeah. We had that place, but we didn't smoke. But you know what? I really proudly look back at the Young Doctors. It never won Logies. It didn't do any of that. But it was such a backbone of Australian television at the time.
I agree.
And, hey, you know, we outlasted the Sullivans, which was a great show, and went on to be in our place. But, you know, I'm extremely proud to be part of that cast as a young guy from Hobart
Tasmania. Tell me about the studio, because there's a story behind that amazing. People think it's a television studio, Channel 9, in fact, in Sydney, but it wasn't, was it?
No, it was that your little studio in North Sydney, and embedded in suburbia, Fred, which was amazing. And John Alexander, the famous tennis player and our politician, was on our backyard, and we used to say, "Hi, John." He would see the green room.
Yep.
It was embedded right in the middle of North Sydney, but it was a studio that wasn't really meant for video. When it really got hot, the TV cameras would turn off. But there was an incredible culture in the Young Doctors cast and crew, and I'm pleased to say that that has gone on for years. And, of course, we've lost Corny, we've lost Gwen, Michael,
yes,
Alfred, Judy McBurney. We've lost a number of people. But there's this great camaraderie between the still remaining cast. Tim Page, Abigail, lives on the Central Coast where I live.
Yep.
I see Tim quite regularly. We've worked in local theatre together. And you know what? I think Doctors was the very fact that it cast the die, if you like, for future shows like Prisoner and all of Grundy's productions is amazing.
I have to say, you are one of the best spokespersons for this show. I've never done an interview with someone that is so loving of what you did and what you're doing at the moment. It's still a part of your life. And you know yourself, there's a lot of actors that used to do TV shows, and I've interviewed a couple people from Prisoner. I won't mention any names, but they're so miserable. They'll say to you, Prisoner was just one of those jobs, and yet they became hits in Prisoner. They became stars, but they won't acknowledge it because it was a prison drama. Young Doctors, like you said, you had a lot of new actors that made it elsewhere.
Fred, I think it's disingenuous to be that. You know, I guess I'm fortunate enough to still be alive and speak on behalf of my Young Doctors colleagues. I'm 64, so I'm getting on there.
That's still young. That's still very young.
But you know what? Thank you. You know, mate, it was an amazing time. I'm a young guy from Tasmania. I've come when I was 16.
Yeah.
And I got into Young Doctors because Alan Coleman, our producer, had actually signed me for Class of 75. I've been signed for Ben Hall. He brought me back. But there is just so much, you know, what to celebrate about Australian TV. We have the best TV, I believe, in the world.
I agree.
You know, the cultural cringe goes, we don't, but we do. If you look at what America has, there's umpteen thousand channels. But you know what? I think if I speak on behalf of the Young Doctors cast, we're indebted to the Australian people. You know, we love doing the show. It wasn't ever meant to be a great drama.
Exactly.
It was a soap. And, you know, it's for me to be here talking to you tonight is such a great privilege because after all these years, 40 years, imagine doing that.
We're going to take you straight to the limit of time here at our show. But can I just ask you, tell people quickly who Dennis was in the show, your role.
Sorry, say that again?
Who was Dennis?
Oh, my role was Dennis. Okay, so Dennis started being an orderly. He became a nurse, and if the show had kept going like Home and Away, I would have been a bloody brain surgeon.
You would have been a doctor, I reckon. Damn. Hey, tell me about your
brain surgeon.
What about your job now? What are you doing? I know you're in Gosford. You're working for the City Council.
Yeah, I work for Central Coast Council. I am the manager of arts and culture for the council. I've been there for 8 years. I look after a couple of theatres, the art galleries and the art scene, and it's an absolute privilege to work for my community. I've always considered myself as a public servant, no different now except I'm officially am. And, you know, we've just had, like today, we've just done, well, actually yesterday and today we've done five shows of Bluey, sold out, you know, that great well Bluey. Yeah.
Well, they couldn't have a better person running it. You know that. Can I just tell you, we're actually, people probably think, what are they on talking about? The Young Doctors, do you reckon they'll ever come back? Will they ever do a remake?
No, but the good thing is, thanks to you and all sorts of people, there is a DVD set, thanks to BioVision, and we can relive that. No, I don't think it should come back. I think we've moved on from there. But, hey, for all those people that loved us, we absolutely love you.
Can I tell you, let me tell you the details. A Young Doctors Collection 1, 250 first episodes. It comes out on the 16th of June, 2021. We want people to go to Via Vision's website. It's on screen right now. Please buy the DVDs. I'm assuming, Chris, you might have some residuals in that, so you might get a couple of dollars out of it, hopefully.
No, it's not about the money, Fred. Yeah, it's always been about the delivery of our fans.
No, I agree with you. And I tell you what, back then they probably didn't do residuals, I think. I know that Val Lehman told me once in Prisoner that she was the only one that was able to put that in her contract. But you know what? You're wonderful. If you ever do a reunion in Perth, let us know and we'd love to have you back on the show. It is the Young Doctors, of course. Chris King is a legend. We love having you on the show. You've been great. I'd love to talk to you again down the track. And we wish you all the best.
Anytime, Fred.
Thank you for your time.
And thanks to you. And thank you. Yeah, all the best, mate. Thanks to you and your crew. Cheers.
Good on you, Chris. And you're not old at all.
Bye.
Thank you very much. Well, that's it for us. Spoke too much with Chris. That is the show. Hope you enjoyed. Check out the DVD collection. I'll see you next week. Thanks to the crew. Have a wonderful week. Keep smiling. Bye for now.